and that we've got Mayan Song coming up on September 21st. That lecture is going to start at 5:30 due to some scheduling conflicts, so make sure you come here really early to get a seat for that one. That's going to be a very full talk. Then on November 2nd, we have Amal Andreas coming, who's the current Dean of Columbia and a partner in Work AC. That would also be a kind of very popular talk, so make sure you come early to that one as well. And then last but not least, we have Martha Schwartz coming, who is an internationally renowned landscape practitioner and educator. And we're super happy to have Martha join us on November 16th. And incredibly excited tonight to have Professor Mutsuro Sasaki join us at USC. And here to introduce Professor Sasaki tonight is Dr. Anders Carlson, of our faculty here at USC. So thanks, Anderson.
As a practicing structural engineer entrenched in architectural academia, it is a great honor for me to introduce Professor Mutsuro Sasaki. Since he will tell you some of the details of how he got to where he is today, creating new collaborative design approaches to realize previously impossible, rational, and sensible building forms. I will skip those details other than to say that he founded his own company in 1980, got a PhD in 1999, and has taught at Hosei
University.
University. I know how to say university, not Hosei. since 2004, where he is now an emeritus professor. But first, a quiz for the students. Have you heard of Toyo Ito? Raise your hands. Those of you who aren't raising your hands, are you awake? What's going on? How about SANAA? How about Arata Isozaki? All right. Well, here is what they all have to say about Professor Sasaki. Toyo Ito. The resolve to take on the challenge of the unknown can be perceived in structures designed by Mutsuro Sasaki. This tension brings a finely honed beauty to space. Kazuyo Sejima and Ryu Nishizawa from SANAA had to say, Mr. Sasaki has been kindly joining us to think about whatever it is that we might be thinking. And Arata Isozaki wrote, the dazzling creation of shapes while making full use of computer algorithms, Mutsuro Sasaki is now actualizing the concepts of Gaudi's unfinished inverted suspension experiments. Entering the 21st century, these previously unknown architectural structures are making their first appearance. And from his own book, Flux Structures, which I got him to autograph a half hour ago, he says, according to Auguste Perret, often called the father of modern architecture, structure is the architect's mother tongue. The architect is a poet who thinks and speaks in structure. Sasaki emphasizes in his book the importance of collaboration between engineers and architects to use today's computational tools to unify mechanics, rationality, and aesthetics, sensibility. Think of his approach as a modern day Vitruvius. And just to embarrass myself, I wrote a haiku for tonight's event, which should have you students thinking about exploring the opportunities that await you when you graduate. Solid flowing curves, rational and sensible. You and Sasaki? Thank you. And please help me in welcoming Sasaki.
Thank you very much. good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am Mutsuro Sasaki, a structural engineer from Tokyo. It's very honor to me to be invited here at USC this evening. I have just turned 70 years this year. As a result, I have retired from a professorship at Hosei University in Tokyo this spring. As an emeritus professor now, I have finally earned some free time for myself and was able to accept this offer to come here and give a talk this evening. When I was in college, I was very good in math, but not so much in English. My age doesn't seem to be helping here either. So tonight, I have a special guest from my MIT and a former member of my office, Mr. Inamura, who will be assisting my lectures. Thank you, Inamura-san. And thank you, everyone, for your cooperation and kind understanding. さて、この講演では主にフラックストラクチャーの形態創生に主題して仙台メディアテイクから最近の RC 重局面シェルの実現までの流れについてお話をしたいと思います。
Tonight I will talk about the morphogenesis of flux structures. I will explain my design and engineering philosophy by unfolding the process behind my projects from Sendai Mediateque to more recent work on RC freeform shell structures.
ここでフラックストラクチャーとは何かについて簡単にお話をしていきます。現代の構造デザインにおいて自由、複雑、不定型、流動的、有機的といった特徴を持つ新しい三次元的な構造物の創造は現代建築を拡張する上で今や国際展にもコンテンポラリーのテーマになっております。しかしそれを真に合理的に実現するためには従来の経験的な構造デザイン思想に代わって力学と美学を統合した理論的な形態デザイン思想が必要です。
I will start off by explaining what flux structure isfree form, complex, irregular, dynamic, and organic. This new structural typology has become international trends in contemporary architecture scenes. Historically, structural design process was based on the heuristic knowledge of the engineers. The more you build, the more you understand what works and what doesn't. However, in order to truly faithfully and rationally design, engineer, and construct these new types of building structures, there are limits to which we can extend our traditional design approach. We need a new theoretical process to derive these forms that can synthesize the aesthetics with the principle of structural mechanics.
私が提唱する形態デザイン手法には、感度解析手法と進化論的構造最適手法があり、生物の進化や自己組織化などの原理を工学的視点で捉えてコンピューター内で合理的な構造形態を創出するものです。これらの形態デザイン手法によって作られたダイナミックで流動的な形態抵抗型の構造を総称して私はフラックストラクチャーと呼んでおります。
There are two processes I proposed and developed in deriving these rational forms. Sensitivity analysisand evolutionary structural optimization. These processes take the principle of biological evolutions and self-organization through the lens of mechanical engineering, and computationally derived structurally rational forms. These structures often take fluid and dynamic form. These forms are what makes them stronger.And more resistant against external loads. I call these form resistant structures as flux structures.
この左の方の写真は、私の大学の退職記念の時のポスターです。タイトルは構造デザインの射程、サブタイトルは構造構築建築となってます。で私とコラボレートした日本の大学の建築である磯崎新、伊藤豊、SANAA たちとの計7回にわたる連続対談をし、あれが私の最終講義、すると、私の教え子たちとの展覧会ですね、そういったものを案内したもので、3月に全部終わっております。 まあ、バックの、 あのこのチューブは仙台メディアテイク の、 あのチューブ下から折った写真です。からあの B の方の図は仏教哲学に基づく人生の曼荼羅図を描いたもので、私の心の支えとしているものですが、ここでは割愛します。
Last year, we had a year-long event at Hosei University to conclude my final year of professorship. Title of this event was Range of Structural Design, and subtitle was Structure, Construction, and Architecture. This event was organized in three modules. First was a series of seven lectures in conversation with each and every one of my lifelong collaborators, including Arata Isozaki, Toyo Ito, Sejima and Nishizawa of SANAA. This lecture series was followed by my final lecture and closed with a public exhibition in Tokyo showcasing a body of work from my own practice as well as my students. Image on the left is a poster from a Sendai Mediateque. Image on the right is from a mandala, or mandala, a spiritual symbol in Buddhism. It represents the universe and resonates very close to my heart.
これは私のデザインフィロソフィーを簡単に図したものです。大きく、ストラクチャーからコンストラクションから
アーキテクチャ
これをその3つに図式化した絵です。私は構造エンジニアですので、第一にその本質エッセンスとしてストラクチャーを、でそれに今度は実体論ですね、としてコンストラクション、それから現象論として建築、こういう形にしたものがスパイラルに関連し合ってるっていう、そういう図式です。
There are three entities that construct my design philosophy: structures, constructions, and architecture. Each one of them is best described with each school of thoughts: essentialism, realism, and phenomenology.These three entities form a loop and together find a balance and derive my design process. As a structure engineer, I consider structure as an essence of design. I place mechanics and aesthetics as its essential attributes. Moving on to construction, where I consider engineering and technologies as the reflection of reality.Finally, on to architecture, space and form constructs phenomena.
この図式に示すように、私の基本テーマは、構造の自由度と美学の追求であり、また私のモットーは、構造の美や力学的合理性の近傍にあるという言い方ができます。これらを実際の構造デザインで、実践した結果が、この後にお話しする仙台メディアテイクであり、あるいは RC 自由メンシェルによる手島美術館などの作品です。最後に私のミッションとして考えている、ものに構造の系譜と歴史的継承について簡単にお話しします。歴史的継承とは先人から継承した遺産をどう継承するかということです。後ほどフレームストラクチャーとスペシャルストラクチャーのそれぞれの系譜について、どういうふうに関わってきたかをお話しいたします。
My goal is in the pursuit of structural freedom and aesthetical exploration. I believe elegance in structure exists in the vicinity of mechanical rationality.Sendai Mediateque and Teshima Art Museum is an example of application of this design philosophy in practice. As an engineer, we learn from the past, from classical principle of mechanics to dynamics, computational design and engineering. Buildings and cities reflect both success and failure of the heritage passed by our ancestors. As a fellow engineer in this world, it is my responsibility to inscribe how I position myself within the lineage of this inheritance, and to leave a clear guidance for the next generation of fellow engineers. In this lecture, I will attempt to unfold this process by presenting the history and lineage of flaming structures as well as shell structures, and explaining where and how I place my thoughts and works.
その話に行く前に、形や構造の自由度について、基本的な話をしておきます。ここに示すいくつかの図、いくつかの図は、建築空間の創造において自由な形を実現することはいかに困難であるかを示したものです。構成された空間には質と量があって、質が形から量がスケールです。形を規制するものとしては力学法則、経済、材料工法などが挙げられます。ダイナミクス and economics and material and construction method。 一般に形の自由度はスケールの増大とともに減少します。それは図1に示すスケールに対する、この図ですね。これは普遍的な力学原理です。どうしてもスパンを拡大する必要がある場合には、図のようにビームからアーチがテンションという、コンプレッション、ベンディング、コンプレッション、アテンション、そういう形でシステム、あるいは材料を適切に選ぶ必要がある。構造の知識が乏しいのは仕方がないんですが、スケール感に欠けた建築は困ったものです。それと図3、これは1960年代に、自由な形への挑戦を試みたいくつの例ですが、シドニーのオペラハウスのようなウッソンのフリーハンドのものは結果的には球面シェルになったし、からトルハの立ちクラブなどの自由曲面シェルは実際には計画段階だけで終わって実現されておりません。
I will start by explaining the fundamentals of formal freedom and flexibility available in structural systems. These illustrations explain how difficult it is to create free-form space in architecture. Space has both quality and quantity. Quality is the form, and quantity is the scale. Form is bounded by structural mechanics, economy, material supply, and construction methods. Freedom and flexibility in form decreases as its scale increases. This is based on the theory of mechanics applied to the scale. This is a universal theory. If increase in span is of absolute necessity, structural system and material selection needs to be re-evaluated. It is very difficult to work with designers and architects who lack this sense of scale. Especially in this modern era of computational design and engineering, my first advice for young designers and architects here with me tonight is to train and shape and sharpen your sense of scale. Figure 3 shows 1960s challenge in achieving freeform buildings. In the field of shell and spatial structures, formal freedom is hand in hand with structural freedom. In the case of Sydney Opera House, original hand drawing drawn by an architect, Utzon, shows the use of this very attractive freeform shell. However, the scale was the dominant factor in this project. And after many twists and turns, later with Arab's support, the final form was realized in the classical form of spherical shell. Image on the right, Edward Troher's freeform shell was terminated at the design phase and never been realized.
それでは次に先ほど の, あのフレーム構造とドーム構造の構造の系譜の話に入ります。古代より現代に至るまで基本的に針柱にあるフレーム構造とドームのような空間構造の2つの構造の系譜に分類される。最初にフレーム構造の系譜についてお話しします。嘘かも、音とかしてない。フレームストラクチャーのリネージですね。からその一番代表的な古代建築で代表的なものが、はい、紀元前432年のパルテノン神殿。これは石のフレームです。これがフレームのオリジナルですね。それから約2400年経って、ミス・ファンデロイのシーグランビルが作られている。まあ、これ近代建築の代表です。もちろんこの美しいプロポーションには私自身学生時代に非常にいい感動した記憶があります。からこれは洗練された均質なグリッド状の鉄骨のフレームです。そして今度はコンテンポラリーアーキテクチャーではその半世紀後、まあ、それの代表として伊藤豊洋による仙台メディアテイクがあります。もはやフレームはディサピアルフレームランダン and Flux Space、 そういうチューブによる構造になっています。これも鉄骨のドミノ構造と言っています。これについては後ほど詳細にお話をします。
From classical period to modern era, generally speaking, typologies of building structures can be categorized in two lineage: framing structures with beams and columns and shell structures with domes and alike. I'll first explain the lineage of framing structures. Good example from the classical period is the Parthenon from 432 BC. This is a framing structure made of a masonry. This is the origin of the framing structure. 2400 years later, in 1958, Seagram building by Mies van der Rohe became the symbol of modern architecture. When I was in your age at my college, I immediately fell in love with Mies' beautiful proportions. Its steel framing structure in precisely and homogeneously arranged grid system. Almost a half a century after this, Toyo Ito's Sendai Mediateque marked a symbol of contemporary building in year 2000. Here, framing members are almost disappeared from the space, composing a domino structures with random and fluid tubular structures.
次に空間構造の系譜についてお話しします。古代建築で代表的なものは128年のパンテオンです。これがレンガと無菌コンクリートのドームで、空間構造の起源といえます。それから約今度1830年経った後、近代建築の代表としてはフェリックス・キャンデラのバカルディの瓶詰め工場1959年ですが上がります。空間構造の系譜の中ではこれは私が学生時代にあり一番感銘を受けた作品です。HP ハイパーブリックパラボロイドという幾何学的曲面によるもので規則です的ですが大変優美な RC シェルです。ところが1960年代後半になってこのような RC シェルの建設が世界の建築界から一斉に姿を消し始めたんです。それは僕にとってはとても悔しくて悲しいことでした。その後、約半世紀の空白を埋めるように、私自身造形的なアルシェルの復活を試みてきました。その執念で生まれたのが2010年の自由形態自然回帰を主題とする RC 自由曲面シェルの手島美術館です。これについても後ほど詳細にお話しします。
Next, I will explain the lineage of shell structures. Prime example from the classical period is Pantheon in 128 AD. This is a dome structure with bricks and non-reinforced concrete. This makes the origin of shell structures. Almost 1800 years after this, Felix Candela's Bacardi factory makes a symbol of modern structure. Along with Mies, Candela was my college hero. This building is made of hyperbolic paraboloid shell structures. Geometrically speaking, it was very simple and regular form, but it was also very elegant RC shell structures. However, at the end of the 1960s, these type of creative RC shell structure began to disappear from the rest of the world. This was during my college time, and I was very sad and angry. During this period, I have made various attempts to bring back these types of elegance in creative shell structures. In 2010, almost a half century after the decay of modern shell structures, Teshima Art Museum was completed. With this, I plan to continue exploring new era of freeform shell structures with underlying common theme of freeform and return to nature.
これは先ほどご紹介があった2005年に東京のギャラリーまで開催された私の展覧会フラクストラクチャーを記念して出版された本です。バイリンガルになったので興味のある人はぜひご覧ください。
Flux Structure was originally published in 2005 as a part of my exhibit at Gallery MA in Tokyo. It is now published in bilingual format. If you are interested in my body of work, please refer to it for more details.
これは展覧会の模様を紹介したものです。代表作の仙台メディアテイクやいくつかの RC 自由建築シェルの模型も展示されております。
This exhibition showcased large-scale model of Sendai Mediateque and other freeform RC shell structures.
これは私が構造エンジニアとして共同することが多い建築家は先ほどもご紹介にあったように伊藤豊さんから SANAA が一番多いです。この左の写真、これは伊藤さんのプリカーションの時の授賞式の記念写真です。からそれ以外の、写真は私と彼らとの共同作品の一部を示したものです。30から40程度のそれぞれ、共同作品が あります。
As you may know, majority of my work is in collaboration with the two architects, Toyo Ito on the left and Sejima and Nishizawa on the right. This picture was from a Pritzker Prize reception for Toyo Ito in Boston in 2013. With both of them, I have built over 30 to 40 projects together.
これは伊藤さんと佐野の展覧会に付随してニューヨークのモマで今年の4月に開催されたストラクチャルリネージで日本の構造デザインから学ぶことというシンポジウムです。私もパネラーとして参加しました。日本における建築家と構造エンジニアのコラボレーションには歴史的によその国は見られない大きな成果を上げているということに注目した企画でした。
This is actually from this April at the symposium at MoMA in New York. This symposium titled Structural Lineages was organized by one of my best friends and fellow engineer Guy Nordenson and Professor John Ashendorf from MIT. As a part of MoMA's exhibition on contemporary Japanese architecture, main focus of the symposium was to study the recent success in Japanese architecture scene by unfolding the underlying relationship between architects and structural engineers. From different angles such as history, educational systems, type of practices, and form of apprenticeship.
その代表的なコラボレーションの例に、1960年の東京オリンピックのために建設された谷健三さんと坪井義勝さんによる代々木屋内総合競技場があります。このシンポジウムでは坪井さんの他にも私の先生である木本敏子さんなど合計6名の構造エンジニアによる日本での建築家とのコラボレーションの成果が熱心に議論されていました。
Yoyogi National Stadium was built as a part of the Tokyo Olympic in 1964. This was a great example of a successful collaboration between the architect, Kenzo Tange, and structural engineer, Yoshikatsu Tsuboi. This symposium focused on six structural engineers, including Tsuboi and my own mentor, Toshihiko Kimura.
このように建築家と構造エンジニアのコラボレーションが円滑に進行されるのは、日本では伝統的に建築学科が工学部に属しているので、建築家も構造エンジニアも全く同じ教育を受け、その後大学院に進んでから専門に分科するという欧米とは異なるやや特殊な建築教育制度によるものと思われます。
In Japan, Department of Architecture resides within the Department of Civil Engineering. Both architects and structural engineers go through exactly the same curriculum during their undergraduate program. They only make decisions on which path and career to specialize in when they move to graduate program. Especially during the first 4 years at undergrad, students help each other.In both design studio work as well as engineering assignments. Perhaps this period in the educational system provides a solid foundation between the two and makes a smooth transition for successful collaboration in practice.
欧米流に最初から専門的に分離している皆さんには理解しづらいことかもしれませんが、少なくともコラボレーションの仕方には明確な違いがあると思います。私自身そうした日本独自の教育制度で育ったエンジニアの一人ですが、伊藤さんや SANAA のコラボレーターとしてそれなりにハッピーに仕事を続けてきております。
This type of collaboration and working culture might be slightly difficult to understand when you come from a Western educational system where there is a clear separation between architects and engineers. However, I have to emphasize thatThere is a clear difference in how architects and engineers collaborate. I happen to grow up in Japanese educational systems, and together with architects Toyo Ito and Sejima, I continue to practice as a structural designer.
ここで、エンジニアとしての私の経歴を簡単にまとめたのはこの図です。オリンピックの年の1960年に名古屋大学に入学しております。で、建築を選んだのはその代々木に刺激されて、選んだということですね。入学後その後丹下さんと坪井さんのコラボレーションあったということで、私自身は大学院では構造力学、特に連続体力学を専門に勉強しております。から大学院を修了してその後、俊彦木村のオフィスへ、で10年ほど、修行を積みました。その後の経歴はこの個人誌のリストにある通りで詳細は割愛します。
I'd like to take this moment to talk about my own career as an engineer. Perhaps this may help some of you who might be thinking of their own career choice. I joined Nagoya University in 1964. This was the year of Tokyo Olympic. I was very inspired by the Yogi National Stadiums and immediately decided to study architecture. I slowly started to learn about Tange and Tsuboi during my undergraduate program and decided to study continuous mechanics in graduate program. In 1970, after graduating from my master program, I joined the office of Kimura. I was more interested in learning from real-world practice. Kimura-san was collaborating with then star architects in Japan. With his guidance, I worked in his office over 10 years before establishing my own engineering practice. I've started my practice in 1980.
この経歴の中で最も重要なのは1995年の仙台メディアテックのコンペティションの出来事です。1995コンペティションの仙台メディアテックファーストプライズ。独立後15年経って本格的に自分なりの構造の可能性を模索した頃に、まあ、一大転機となったものです。それは伊藤さんから送られてきた非常に衝撃的な一枚のスケッチ、それに遭遇したことです。
One of the most important turning points in my career was in 1995, during the competition phase for Sendai Mediateque. This was 15 years after I started my own practice, and I just had begun to explore full potential as a structural engineer.
スケッチには伊藤さんのサインとともに、徹底的にフラットスラブ、階層のような柱、ファサードのスクリーンの3要素だけをピュアに表現する、それを徹底的にスタディしてほしいという、そういうコメントがありました。
I received this shocking sketch from Toyo Ito. In this sketch, he says, absolute flat slab, seabed-like columns, screen facade. Please express these three and only three elements in this building. Study each structural element, and together we will do our best to make them as simple as possible.
その不定形なチューブのが階層に揺らぎながら数枚の薄いプレートを支えているという一見すると現実離れをしたものでした。しかしそのスケッチにはエンジニアとしての私の想像力をかきたて挑発する強い力が存在しておりました。伊藤さんの独創的な建築的イメージを象徴的に表現したものであるということが瞬間的に理解できたのです。
Irregular tubes are floating in a space, swaying and supporting very thin structure plates. It was almost unreal.However, in this sketch, I found strong potentials and power that challenges my creativity as a structural engineer. It was also expressing Ito's unprecedented creativity in abstract form.
このスケッチは自然でオーガニックな構造を喚起させるものであり、それと同時に建築と不可分な構造のあり方を示すことを目指していることです。それは今日の講演テーマのフラックストラクチャーとも根底のところでつながる考え方で仙台以降の私のデザイン活動の出発点となっています。おそらく伊藤さんも同様かと思いますが仙台メディテックは私にとって一大転機のある重要なプロジェクトでした。
This sketch calls for return to nature and its organic structures. It also suggestsAn inseparable relationship between architecture and structure. This philosophy is very much in line with the theme of tonight's lecture, flat structure. Sendai marked the beginning of a new chapter in my career as an engineer. I believe it was equally significant project for Ito's career.
それを物理的に実現するために全力を尽くしたことは言うまでもありません。
Together we worked very hard with days and nights to bring this idea into fruition.
以下簡単に仙台メディアテイクの紹介をいたします。これは伊藤さんのスケッチに対して私が提案した構造システム図です。徹底して薄い床には軽くて強いステル製のサンドイッチ板を提案しております。そしてこの床は透明性の高い13本のチューブが支えています。太い直径の4本のチューブには鋼管をチピン状に組んだラチス柱で地震にも抵抗する主体構造として地震時にねじが起きないように 四隅にバランスよく配置しています。中間の細い直径の9本の柱は円柱荷重だけを支える浮き柱としております。地下には地震エネルギーを吸収するエネルギー、工夫がなされております。
I will briefly explain the Sendai Mediateque. This is a structural system I propose in response to Ito's sketch for the absolute thin floors in Ito's walls. I propose a light and strong steel laminated plate. These floors are supported by 13 sets of highly transparent tubes. Four of the larger diameter tubes are made of steel pipes that form HP lattice. This provides lateral stiffness that resists against earthquake. They are placed around each corner of the building to prevent overall deflections, vibrations, and eccentric twists during the earthquake. Nine of the smaller diameter tubes are designed in such a way that they only support vertical load. Basement is designed as a seismic damping system to absorb earthquake energy.
これはサンドイッチ版のリブの配置を示した図です。力学的には主要力の流れに沿って合理的に配置しています。
This is an inside of a sandwich floor plate, showing the arrangement of the internal rib structures. These ribs follow the direction of principal stress, making it as light and as strong as possible.
チューブのジオメトリーです。円筒をねじって、HP 双極放物面の上の筒とします。これによって力学的な座体力を向上させています。さらにこれを据えして全体を揺らいだ形にしています。
This is the geometry of the tube. Twisting the cylinder to make HP shell, this provides higher performance against buckling.Once this is confirmed, shearing each module to introduce the swaying effect that Ito had in his mind.
これは地下の地震エネルギーを吸収する仕掛けを図示したもの。あ、違うね。これは床と、チューブと床の取り合いを示したものです。
This is the intersection between the tubular structures and floor slabs.
これは地下の地震エネルギーを吸収する仕掛けを図示したものです。
This shows the mechanism in the basement designed to absorb seismic energy.
代表的な現場の写真です。
Typical construction site.
外観写真。
Extra shot? Sorry, exterior shot.
一階の写真。
Interior view from the ground floor.
小チューブの見上げ写真です。
Looking up inside through a smaller diameter tubes.
以上が仙台メディアテクです。次にもう一つの大きな出会いが、これからお話しする RC 自由曲面シェルの構造デザインに大いに関係するもので、あります。1993年にフェリックス・キャンデルに会ったときに、彼からガウディの建築のことを、いろいろ教えられました。でそこでは、ここではフラックストラクチャーを構想する上で、ガウディから何を遺産として継承してヒントを得たのかについてお話しします。
There was another moment, an important moment, important person that helped shaping my professional careerThis relates to the second chapter of tonight's lecture, Freeform RC Shell Structures. In 1993, I had an opportunity to meet a hero of my youth, Felix Candela. Candela taught me the depths of Gaudi's work and underlying intricacy between architecture, construction, and structure. To be honest, I told Candela that I was not really a big fan of Gaudi's work. He scowled at me and opened my eyes. I will now explain what I learned from Gaudi and how I attempted to take it to the next level.
重局面の形を合理的に決定する歴史上の実験的な手法について話します。左の座ガウディのグエル国教会のために行った模型実験の模様です。森によってエクサリニア引っ張り力が働きますが、それをひっくり返すと今度は圧縮だけに働くフニクラーチになります。それは引っ張り山毛には弱い石像の建築にとっては非常に理想的な形になります。でこのガウディの方法を今度は局面に応用したのがスイスの構造家のハインツ・イスラーのよる模型実験です。これはガーゼに石膏を含ましてそれで支点を適当に選んで釣ってやると今度は石膏が固まってそれを反転してあげるというそういうものです。
This is the physical simulation model he developed for the design of Guelph Church. It represents the hanging chain model with each weight in place. Each chain exhibits only the tensile stress. As a result, it makes a form of pure catenary. Reversing it upside down, it makes compression only funicular arch.Stones and masonries are weak in tensions and bending. Having it in full compression, this arch makes an ideal form for masonry structure. Extending Gaudi's study into a curved surface, a Swiss engineer, Heinz Isler, developed another physical simulation model. Here, he appliedviscous cement onto fabric, arranging the boundary conditions, and suspended this fabric under gravity. Once the cement is cured, flipping it upside down to derive pure compression, covering your shell structures.
さっき話した模型実験による方法は合理的な方法ですけれども、これには大変な労力と時間を必要とするので、現代ではあまり実用的な方向とは言えません。私の提案した方法は、模型実験によって形を作る過程をコンピューターアルゴリズムに置き換えるというものです。模型実験での職人的な技術に頼ることもなく、現代の高度情報技術を駆使して、もっと早く、もっと正確に、理学的に合理的な重機無限支援の形を作り出すというアイデアです。1999年に名古屋大学の教授に就任したのをきっかけに早速構造最適化手法の研究を始めました。
Now I explain my own process for designing logical freeform shell structures. Use of physical model is very useful but requires enormous time and effortthat is nowadays becoming increasingly difficult to afford in modern practice. What I proposed is a translation of this physical model, or physical model-based simulation into computer algorithms. Unlike physical model, where the accuracy and the results depend on the craftsmanship, computer-based simulationallows designers and engineers to derive the rational form with higher accuracy and speed. In 1999, I was appointed as a professor at Nagoya University, and I began to study developing, the structural optimization methods.
合理的な RC 重局面シェルを求めるための感度解析と呼ぶ手法で、それによって理想的な構造形態を求めるというものです。 2002年にだいたい理論的な研究のめどが立ったので、実験実の構造デザインに応用してみようと思いました。その最初の適用例が磯崎慎さんの北方障害学習センターで、実用的な方法として十分使えるという実感を得ました。
This first method is called sensitivity analysis. It returns structurally optimum form that resists external force with its geometrical stiffness. In 2002, this research work at the university came to a good fruition and I decided to implement this method in practice. The first project was in collaboration with Arata Isozaki for Kitakata Learning Center. During this project, I gained confidence that this method is applicable in real practice.
これはキャンデラのバカルディの瓶詰め工場、から先のトロハのタチエルクラブなど、まあ、歴史的に高い評価を受けているある施設に対して感度解析手法で検証を行ったものです。その結果得られた最終形状は、まあ、この図が示すようにオリジナルのものとそれほど変わらないんですが、応力変形は大幅に減少して工学的に大変に説得力のある結果が得られております。これで感度解析による携帯デザイン手法が実用的にかに対して非常にまあ絶対的な確信が得られたものです。
Using my sensitivity analysis, I ran a series of studies to evaluate the work of Candela and Edward Troher. Formally, result doesn't seem to show much of a change. However, this computational method can significantly improve the structural performance of the original form by reducing the stresses and displacements. This further confirmed the value of pursuing my researchand applying this method in practice.
変形がキャンデラの場合約半分ぐらい減ってて、それからタチエラの場合は10倍ぐらい違う。
The maximum displacement value in the candela's case was reduced into half.
20倍か。
While in the case of Troher, it was around 20 times smaller.
それ以来この一覧表に示すように日本を代表する4人の建築家のコラボレーションのもとに今まで5つの自由曲面シルを実現してきました。最初の新たに磯崎さんとの岐阜のラーニングセンター、それから伊藤さんとのグリーンからこれも伊藤さんとの、瞑想の森、なんだっけ、
クラマトリオル、
それからこれは、SANAAとのロレックスラーニングセンター、これは西澤龍恵さんとの Teshima Art Museum です。
So after the first project with Arata Isozaki and a series of a test in my labI built over 5 projects with this free-form RC shell structures. The first one is the Kitakata with Arata Isozaki. The second one is a green with Toyo Ito in the south of Japan. The third one is a crematorium in Gifu that is also in collaboration with Toyo Ito. Fourth one moves to outside of Japan at Rolex Learning Center with SANAA. And then the fifth one is back to Japan, is the Teshima Art Museum in collaboration with Ryue Nishizawa of SANAA.
ここでは時間の都合もあるので、3つ目以降の種類についてだけ簡単にこの後紹介します。第3作目は伊藤さんとの瞑想の森です。周辺の里山の風景の中に雲のように浮かんだ建築を作ろうとしたもので、軽快で優美なフリーエッジの自由曲面シェルです。
The third project that I showed you earlier was in collaboration with Ito for Gifu Crematorium. We wanted to design a building that appears to float like a cloud in the scenery. This set the objective for the designing a lightweight and edge-free freeform RC shell structures. Each of these columns integrate lift drainage inside and randomly placed in space to make about 20 meters span in between. This was followed by accident that during the completion ceremony, people just started to climb up on the roof.
ここでは、建築技術を持つ型枠ファブリケーターがとても素晴らしい型枠工法を提案してくれました。その陰で、通常の工法よりもずっと滑らかで美しい局面とすることができています。We
were lucky in this project that this project was situated near the manufacturer of Toyota, where they have a lot of CAD/CAM system to fabricate a scaffold. Thanks to them, unlike a traditional veneer-based scaffolding, we were able to generate much smoother underlying surfaces.
4作目は SANAA との Rolex Learning Center です。 ローザンに立つセンター、学生センターで初めて床に自由空間シェルを適用したものです。
This is a Rolex Learning Center in collaboration with SANAA. It's a student center situated in Switzerland. This is the first project I applied sensitivity analysis to generate floor structure.
ファサード部分は約80メーター、ライズが6メーターという RC としてはかなり扁平で大きなスパンのアーチ構造になってます。
Looking at this through the lens of classical arch structure, this front facade spans 80 meters and rise only 6 meters, which makes extremely flat arch.
床の場合は歩行障害を生じないように勾配を微妙に調整するなど形態デザインの適用には苦労しました。
There were far more constraints than designing a roof this time because of regulation for people to walk on. So there was a lot of like regulation for like slope angles and stuff.
型工法は一般的な方法ですが、打ち上がりは大変綺麗になっております。
Formwork in this case was rather traditional, but then it turned out very well.
これはその時の現場のスナップ写真です。実設計の方はドイツのB&Gという事務所にお願いしておりました。This
was a photo from construction site. The local engineer was Boringer and Gorman from Switzerland.
5作目が西澤さんとの手島美術館です。 2010年に竣工してます。
The last project is a Teshima Museum in collaboration with Sejima and Nishizawa of SANAA.
これについては詳細にお話をしたいと思います。小さな美術館、瀬戸内海の手島というところに建設されて、 古都会丘の中腹にあってとても美しい建築になっております。I will
explain this project in more detail. This project is situated in a small island in the west of Japan, with a beautiful background. We decided to come up with a form that suits well to the scene.
私たちはアーティストの作品と共存する建築空間のあり方として、水滴をコンセプトとした建築を提案し、自然環境と美術と建築が一つに融合するということを目指しました。これらのコンセプトに対して構造デザインにおいて造形性と構造的な合理性を両立させながら、扁平で流動的なRC軸面シェルを 実現するという課題に取り組んだわけです。
In collaboration with SANAA, we decided to come up with a space that can work with the local artists. We decided to work on the theme of water droplet and try to synthesize the nature and art through architecture.
構造計画の概要を述べます。屋根はスパンが41メーター ×60 メーターの不定形な平面を持ってて、最大の高さが5メーター、板厚が25センチという非常に扁平なシェルです。
I'll explain the structural principle. The roof spans 41 meter on one axis, 60 meter on the other, very irregular shape.Maximum height of the shell is only 5 meters. Slab thickness is 25 centimeters, which makes a very flat and thin RC shell structure.
屋根はスパンが約、次に屋根形状のシェルスラストの話だっけ？
まだしないですね。
シェルからのスラストを処理するために基礎構造にはプレスレスを導入したタイビームを設けています。
Because of this extremely flat nature, we decided to introduce a pressless tie in the basement to take account for the horizontal thrust on the border.
次に屋根形状の決定の概要について話します。水滴という建築家のイメージにより初期形状がネジされるわけですが、そのままの形では力学的合理性を持っているとは言えません。そこで、コンピューターによる形態創生手法を利用して建築家のイメージを損なわない範囲で力学的に健全なシェル形状を誘導する必要があります。専門的になりますが、目的関数に歪みエネルギー、設計変数にナーバス点で制御された座標を選び、解析手法には最急降下法を用いて最適化問題に帰着させております。
Now I explain design and engineering process of the shape of a roof. The initial design of water droplet has set the initial form of roof. However, the original formis far away from structural rationality. Therefore, we decided to introduce computational morphogenesis. And while preserving the original intent of an architect, we decided to find an optimum shell structure. In terms of the detail,the objective function was strain energy. Design variables were control vertices of nerves. The optimization method were gradient descents.
Shock形状と最終形状にあまり違いがないように見えますけども、最大で40センチほど形が変わっております。この図は進化に応じた変形状態の推移を示しています。形状修正に伴い歪みエネルギーが変形応力が減少していることが理解確認でき、ある程度の曲げを許しつつ全体として磁力抵抗型の合理的な指令へと収束しております。
Once again, it doesn't appear to have much of a change from original design to the final design, but at the maximum point, it deviates about 40 centimeters. This graph illustrates the change in deflection values as we run through the iterative process of structural optimizations. As the foam changes, strain energies, deformations, and stress decrease, as you can tell. The result takes on certain amount of bending stress while achieving more toward an axial type of a rational structural shell.
最後にどもり方工法について、触れておきます。シェルの内側には打ち継ぎがないような一様な、打ちっぱなし面を要求されたことから扁平なシェルの座屈安定性確保のために非常に、精度確保が重要だったという、そういった理由から従来の型枠工法では困難が予想されたので、そこでどもり型枠工法を採用しております。
Finally, I will explain the construction method that we developed. From the architect's end, aesthetically, they did not want to have any seams, as you saw earlier on the work of Rolex. Given the extremely flat nature of this shell, it is very prone to buckling if you don't have the right tolerance.Because of these constraints, we decided to come up with a method where you basically place and carve out a soil from the local area.
まず、扁平なシェルのためにどもり、もう土量も少ないということも、一つの理由です。具体的に、まずシェルの形状にどもりを行って、それで表面にモルタル仕上げをして重曲面を形成し、で型枠としてコンクリートを打設して硬化後に中の土を掘り出すと、そういうものです。
Another reason why we were able to do this was that the, because shell was relatively shallow in height, it didn't require as much soil.As it would otherwise require for a spherical type of shell structures. We first brought soil onto the ground, evaluate at 100 millimeter pitch. Once the initial form is set, we set a mortar on top to provide a three-dimensional form that was prescribed in the CAD environment.This soil plus mortar became the formwork on which we poured the concrete. Once the concrete was cured, then we excavated the soil from the hole.
順番にその様子を次から次へご紹介します。
I'll just quickly go through the construction sequence. This is how it was completed.
これはStructure for Architecture, Form Finding and Optimization という、そういう本が2014年に出版された。その本の第21章に今お話した内容が詳しく詳細されていますので、ぜひともご覧になってください。
The detail of engineering method was described in the last publications. shell structures for architecture, form finding, and optimizations that was just published in 2014. So please refer to that book for detail.
なおこの手島美術館は小さい作品ですけれども、日本のほとんど主要な建築賞を受賞したことを付け加えておきます。
Relatively speaking, the shell was a very small project, but due to the nature of its design process, engineering process, and the construction process, it has quickly earned and virtually all the building awards in Japan.
これからあの手島のムービーをお流しします。2分ほどで終わります。
This is a brief movie of a Teshima Art Museum.
番外編としてもう一つのフラックスストラクチャーについて簡単に紹介したいと思います。重力などの力学的環境に対する生物の適応能力、つまり生命維持のための自己組織化の能力に関係する話です。時間がないのでスライドだけご紹介します。
Now the lecture is coming close to the end. I'll just quickly go through a couple of the images of other type of flux structures that I've been developing. Learning from a nature's where the survival is a critical factor, self-organization's methods can be applicable in the context of computational design. This was originally designed in collaboration with Arata Isozaki for Firenze train stations. Unfortunately, that project didn't go through, but then there was another client in Qatar who found our project and wanted to deploy in one-to-one.
さて、私の講演もそろそろ終わりになります。私の体験を振り返ってみると、私のアイデアの刺激や誘発は偶然の連続であって、大事なことは人や情報との偶然の出会いをどう捉え、必然に変えていくかと、そういうことの積み重ねであったということは、今改めて強く思います。私のキャリアにおいて最大の転機となった仙台メディアテイクから、 今日のメインテーマであるフラックスストラクチャーまでをの私の軌跡について、本日こうして皆さんにお話をして、する機会を与えてくださったことに改めて感謝申し上げます。どうもありがとうございました。
As a closing statement, I would like to reflect my own life and career as an architect, as a structural engineer. For me, the idea, challenge, inspirations all comes by accident and continuation of accidents. The important thing was how you take each accidents of encounters with people and informations and translate into your own creativity. One of the most important moments in my career, the Sendai Mediateque, and also today's main theme, Flux structure. It's been very honored to share my experience with you tonight, and thank you very much for your participation.
Thank you very much.
Anyone? について大きな柱の方は水平力しか取っていないって言われていたので言ってないですよね。
当たり前のことだから
。It should come without saying that each column does take a vertical load, so I just did not explain. He said.
あまりにも当たり前のことだから省略したって。
He did explain. There's 13 columns.Nine of them only take gravity, and the four corner ones take lateral and gravity, keeping the floor plate spans between the 13 columns small.
The ones taking gravity are transparent columns, the cores, or they are like concrete columns?
There are no concrete columns on the superstructure. Concrete の柱が上にあるじゃない。
Any other questions?
When Toyo Ito sent you that sketch of his idea, did he know that it would perform better than traditional structural methods?
いい質問ですね。
Or was it he just trying to express his idea?
伊藤さんがファックスを送られた際に、あの形が、
いいと思わなかった。
思わなかったと。
地震があった直後だった。神戸地震の直後だったからね、夢見てるんじゃないかと思った。
The fax was sent right after one of the biggest earthquakes in Japan, and he thought that was a joke.
だけどすごい魅力的だったね。
あの、
佐々木
さん、今日それでありがとうございます。
日本人の人です
。違う違う違う。皆さんも分かられるために英語で質問します。You have worked with Ito-san and SANAA for about 20 years, if not more now. And I'm often hear the saying that, you know, when you work with someone such a long time, they change you and you also change them. How do you think this statement reflects in you and in Mr. Ito and SANAA?
過去20年間以上コラボレーションされてきて、その間に、伊藤さん、SANAA さんが佐々木さんを、インフルエンスして変えていった。
その逆もある。
He agreed that that is the case, and then the influence is mutual as much as they influence him, and then he believed that he has influenced them. In this book that Sejima explains more of her personal relationship with Sasaki. It's also a rare case that each architect brings their engineer to a prestigious award like Pritzker's. Sasaki was able to attend both for Sejima and Toyo, and he believed that is a reflection of the strong collaborations.
One last question. Yes.
In the case of the design of the shell design, was the optimization of the designed or architecturally intended shape or of an optimization of the structure that created a different, slightly different shape?
Let me explain first and then explain what his answer. The exact map is actually written in this book, but the design intent, only the reason why he thinks that his optimization method is applicable in practice is that it does not negate original design. This type of structural optimization allows you to evaluate the consequence not only on the mechanical performance but also aesthetics. And then he shares the iterative process with the architect, so together you form conclusions.
I understand. Thank you.
All right, well, let's thank our speaker again. Reception area in the Harris courtyard. So please join us out there.